Thank you. The next item of business is topical questions, and if a member wishes to raise a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question, or indicate so in the chat function during the relevant question by entering the letters RTS, request to speak RTS. I call question number one, Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what steps it has taken to address the reported findings of an independent review of the cladding remediation programme that successful delivery of the project is in doubt, with major risks or issues apparent.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robinson.
Thank you. I want to reassure homeowners that the programme is not in any way at risk. It is standard government practice to carry out independent scrutiny of large programmes to ensure that they deliver public value and help them succeed. We will continue to do so, and I fully expect that they will find this programme is making progress. This review recognised that cladding issues cannot be dealt with quickly and provided 8 recommendations which we accepted and have actioned. As I announced in my statement in May, our single building assessment programme has changed since the review was carried out and has been expanded from 27 to more than 100 buildings. This is a complex programme which is moving forward with assessments being completed and discussions on remediation underway.
Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think the idea that the Government has been delivering on the cladding remediation programme is a farce. These reports confirm that homeowners have been given nothing more than the runaround. And it, quoting, risks unmanaged, no plan, a damning verdict that whatever comes next is unclear and successful delivery is in doubt. Presiding Officer, it calls into question that if there was no plan in July, that the statement the Cabinet Secretary made in May was even accurate. Because all summer I've been contacted by families who are worried sick that they are living in unsafe homes. You know, they can't escape, they can't sell, they can't remortgage. Some of them can't even secure insurance. Now, Cabinet Secretary, barely a building has been made safe at all. These documents have pointed out that just one of the 26 in the pilot is expected to be green-lighted for selling or remortgaging. Does the Cabinet Secretary not accept that this is not acceptable, that families who have been contacting me over the summer have been left in absolute despair and they need an update urgently?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, look, I think it's very important that we first of all recognise the concerns that homeowners and families have, of course, and I did that when I made my statement back in May. And I think we also need to recognise that this is a very complex process. It is not easy. Each building that is part of the programme is being kept updated by their factor. Now, if there's issues with that communication, I'm very happy to speak to Mark Griffin about any particular buildings and if there's more we can do to ensure that communication, because a lot of discussions and a lot of meetings are taking place and progress is being made, and it's important that that is communicated. The grant-based model gives the factors a very important role to play, and one of them, of course, is communication. And when we move to a national rollout, communication will then fall to the Scottish Government. We want to make sure that that is as good as it can be. And again, if there's ways that we can make sure that we have listened to members like Mark Griffin about the best way to do that, and of course we will. So in terms of the reports that we've received, they are undergoing technical review. And if anything that needs to be addressed immediately comes to light, then of course it will be. The assessments themselves require complex specialist interventions from fire engineers, and they ensure that surveys are carried out to the highest technical standards. That takes time, and that skill is quite a rare skill. There's not a lot of fire engineers about, so we've had to work hard to get the necessary skills that we require. And of course, we'll then take action based on the recommendations made by these independent fire safety professionals. So I do agree with Mark Griffin that communication is important. And if there's more that we need to do in that space, we will. But assurance to homeowners is also important, and we will do everything we can to make sure that they're able to move forward with their lives as soon as they can.
Mark Griffin.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and would look to to feedback the cases that I have been getting, which it has been difficult to do because they generally are not constituents. They're primarily homeowners in the Edinburgh area, but we'll forward those. But I should also note, I think in the Cabinet Secretary's statement in May, she did promise a cross-party briefing, and that could have given a platform for us to share constituents' concern. But the documents that were released also confirm that the Cabinet Secretary herself set a deadline for an accord with house builders for September, and we're now into November, so I would ask the Cabinet Secretary, where is that agreement with developers? She wrote with Julie James, the Welsh Minister responsible, that the Cabinet Secretary saw no reason why the accord and the pact couldn't be agreed over the summer after the change in UK government rules. The Welsh Government has confirmed last month it signed up Persimmon, Taylor Wimpey, Barratt and others to its pact. So what can the Government say about the developers they have signed up to the accord? What contribution they are going to make towards remediation? And I think for the sake of homeowners, another update to Parliament by parliamentary statement definitely would be helpful from the Cabinet Secretary.
Cabinet Secretary.
So let me take those in order. So the accord is a really critical part of this moving forward, and that's due to be signed in the coming weeks. We've taken the time to make sure we can get as many developers on board as we can, and I want to thank Homes for Scotland and those developers who have come to the table to agree to step up and do the right thing for homeowners. And of course that is their chance to put things right and reassure homeowners that their homes will be fixed. So, as I say, that it will be signed in the coming weeks, and I'm happy to come and give a statement. I wanted to give that statement once we had brought things to a conclusion that was satisfactory in terms of the accord being progressed enough, but I'm happy to come to Parliament, and I will try and do that before the end of the year if I can. I'm also happy to give a cross-party briefing to bring members up to speed with all of these things, and we'll get that organised as quickly as we can.
Supplementary, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I agree with Mark Griffin, because I think there is growing concern at the lack of leadership that we've seen from the Cabinet Secretary or the Scottish Government on this. Our constituents expect action, and I'm concerned with reports I'm having that people living in these buildings are being told that they will be having to pay for this, that not the developer. And I think the Cabinet Secretary needs to be clear at how that's going to be properly resourced and funded. Now, the accord was meant to be delivered in September. We are now here in November. So can she give a guarantee that that work has actually taken place and that people in these developments are being communicated with, because they are facing these conversations from factors that they'll have to foot the bill?
Cabinet Secretary.
So let me just remind Miles Briggs and other members of what I said in my statement, and that is that the reason for the accord is, of course, we want developers who are still in existence and where there is a relationship with a building for them to take responsibility to step up and do the right thing for homeowners. What I've said around those buildings that are essentially orphan buildings where either no developer can be associated or the developer no longer exists is that that is where we will prioritise the spend that the Scottish Government has. And as I also said, around that, we have committed all of the consequentials so far, £400 million, to this programme of work. I think I should also say that the programme is appropriately resourced, and we've expanded our programme, and we're taking priority action to address those buildings in order of priority. And we have committed spend of almost £1 million on assessments so far, and of course we've committed to fund assessments for all of the affected buildings, so homeowners will not need to pay for any of those assessments. And what we want to make sure in terms of remedial action, and a lot of the buildings of course will not require any remedial action because they'll be found to be safe, which is a good thing, and people will then be able to move on with their lives, but where remedial action is required, it is really important that developers are held to account for those buildings that they are responsible for, and that the Scottish Government uses its resources to step in for those buildings where a developer can't be found. I'm happy to go into far more detail than this if members would find it helpful by way of a cross-party briefing and indeed a statement to Parliament.
A supplementary, Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise if she plans to continue with gateway reviews to ensure the programme is in fact on track and that the complex and technical expertise of external support is able to maintain and develop this programme?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I mean, we invite scrutiny of our programmes to ensure that we deliver public value to the highest of standards, and independent examination of any complex programme is standard government practice, and of course we welcome further independent examination of the cladding programme. I commissioned the changes to this programme back in March, which I announced in May, the new direction for the programme, having learned from the experience so far. And the second gateway actually validated that decision, which was helpful. And of the gateway recommendations, all are on track and 4 out of 8 are completed.
I call question number 2, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how much it will cost to fit sensors for the LNG system on Ferry 801, as reported to the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee.
Deputy First Minister John Swinney.
President Officer Fergusson Marine informed the Scottish Government on the 27th of October of an issue relating to the liquefied natural gas system for the MV Glensanex that requires sensors to be procured. Due to issues with global supply chains, ministers are advised this may take of the order of 36 weeks. Ministers are seeking urgent options on the next steps and expect all possible measures to be taken to deliver the vessel to serve islanders as soon as possible. Officials will continue to engage with Fergusson Marine as they assess the full impact of this, including any financial implications, which Fergusson Marine will share with both the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament once this has been confirmed.
Graeme Simpson.
Deputy Presiding Officer, my question was how much will it cost? And I'm afraid the Deputy First Minister hasn't answered that question. So perhaps he can try again. But let me put this to him, because we need to get to the bottom of what's happened here. Was it actually the case that the need for sensors has been known about for some time, but that someone just forgot to place the order? And if that is correct, has anyone fallen on their sword over this or been got rid of? And if not, why not? And I still want to know the cost.
Deputy First Minister.
I gave Mr Simpson the best answer I can give him on the question of an issue that has been raised with the Government just last Thursday, which is that any financial implications which arise from this issue will be shared with both the Government and the Scottish Parliament once that cost has been confirmed by Fergusson Marine. So that is the answer to the question of cost. In relation to the issue that has arisen here, quite clearly the sensors are necessary because, as I understand the function of these sensors, they are part of the safety system around the LNG system that will operate on the Glensanex. Sensors have not been ordered, they have now been ordered, and the answer I have given Mr Simpson is the substantive answer on what is the current estimate of the timescale for the delivery of those sensors.
Graeme Simpson.
I'm having to read between the lines here, Deputy Presiding Officer, so I'm assuming that I am in fact correct that the need for sensors was known and they just weren't ordered. But again, the Deputy First Minister can confirm that. He hasn't answered any of my questions yet. Perhaps he can tell us this. Is he aware of any other issues with the building of the Glensanex? I've been told there are ongoing concerns about certain aspects of the build. And can he also confirm if the Government has recently been asked to provide any extra funding to help keep the yard going?
Deputy First Minister.
I've addressed the substantive points that Mr Simpson has raised with me. He's then said that he has asked me if I have any further concerns about the or any issues been drawn to my attention. Well, as Mr Simpson will know, there is regular reporting on the progress in relation to the Glensanex, which is shared with the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. He then went on to say that he's had concerns about certain aspects of the build. With the greatest of respect, that's not the most specific comment that's ever been put to me in the parliamentary chamber, certain aspects of the build. So if Mr Simpson has other specific concerns, he can, of course, raise them with me. And in relation to the financial position in relation to the contract, Mr Simpson is aware of the details that have been shared with Parliament in relation to the estimates by the management team at Ferguson's about the financial implications of their assessment of the current work programme. That has been assessed by the government, and further decisions about that will be taken in due course once that assessment has been completed.
A supplementary, Emma Roddick.
Presiding officer, I think it's safe to say that the ferries network has become a bit of a favourite plaything of the Tories lately. But as someone who represents a great many islanders, I know of the importance of these vessels and also of the Scottish Government's strong commitment to the provision of lifeline ferry services. Can I ask the Deputy First Minister what progress is being made on the two vessels recently announced and indeed on enhancing resilience and capability on the whole Clyde and Hebrides network?
Deputy First Minister.
Since the government was elected in May 2021, we have purchased and deployed the MV Lough Frisa. We've obviously taken forward the construction of the vessels 801 and 802. We've commissioned two new vessels for the Islay routes and progressed improvements to key ports and harbours. We've also taken further investment decisions. The Transport Minister has announced that CMAL are progressing procurement of a further two major vessels, which will deliver significantly increased capacity and reliability for the communities of the Western Isles and improve resilience across the wider Clyde and Hebrides network. The procurement notice for those vessels was published on the 27th of October, with a deadline for submission by the 6th of December. In addition to the ongoing vessel investments, we will expand the tide and weather monitoring equipment currently in place at CMAL ports to other third-party ports. We'll progress the Sky Triangle and Islay route port works and continue the work to improve harbour infrastructure for Arran services.
A supplementary, Edward Banton.
Presiding officer, and back to the problem of the missing safety valves. It appears there was a long-term need for these valves, and Tim Hare, when he was appointed, at vast expense, took on a new warehouse, carried out a complete stock check, confirming that all the parts were there. He obviously missed these. Is Tim Hare now an expensive £2 million mistake?
Deputy First Minister.
I think, obviously, there has been a parliamentary committee assessment of the steps that have been taken to deliver these ferries. Interim management was put in place to take forward the construction of the vessels. The yard, under the leadership of David Tideman, is making good progress in advancing those vessels, and the government will work with Ferguson's to ensure that we complete the construction of 801 and 802 to enable these vessels to be deployed on the network to deliver the quality of service we expect for islanders.